Our gathering song this morning can be found in your bulletins. Please join together in singing, "Morning Has Broken."
Easter to everyone.
Happy Easter.
The second time we gather in this Easter season. Every time we gather as the people of God, we come together with a sense of joy and gratitude. But today our joy and gratitude is increased immensely because Malcolm and Brittany Fye have been blessed with the gift of new life. Every single human life has its origins in the heart of God. Malcolm and Brittany, your daughter is exceptionally well known to God. We hear in the Psalms that God knows us so well, he even knows the number of hairs upon our head. It is now the desire of God's people to come to know your daughter. And so on behalf of the church, I ask you, what name have you decided to give to your beautiful daughter? And have you come here asking for baptism for Emery? In doing so, you are accepting the responsibility of training her in the ways of the faith. She's to learn to love God, to love her neighbor, and to love herself. You clearly understand what you're undertaking. And Haley and Michael and the people of St. Agnes, are you willing to help these parents in their duty as Christian parents? Emily Jane, the Christian community welcomes you with great joy. In its name, I claim you for Christ our Savior with the sign of the cross that I trace upon your forehead. I ask your mom and dad and your godparents to also trace a cross upon her forehead. And as Emery Jane is being marked with the sign of salvation, so too we pray in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And may the peace of the risen Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
God has blessed us in exceptional ways. God has given us the gift of new life. For all of God's blessings, let us joyfully sing of his glory.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to be. For you.
us pray. God of life, source of all faith, through the waters of baptism, you have raised us up in Jesus Christ and given us life that endures. Day by day, refine our faith, that we who have not seen the Christ may truly confess him as our Lord and God and share the blessedness of those who believe. Grant this through Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
Our first reading is a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The community of believers was the one heart and mind, was of one heart and mind, and no one claimed that any of his possessions was his own. But they had everything in common. With great power, the apostles bore witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great favor was accorded them all. There was no needy person among them, for those who owned property or houses would sell them and bring the proceeds of the sale and put them at the feet of the apostles. And they were distributed to each according to need. The word of the Lord.
Everlasting.
The second reading is a reading from the letter of St. John. Beloved, everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is begotten by God, and everyone who loves the Father loves also the one begotten by him. In this way, we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For whoever is begotten by God conquers the world. And the victory that conquers the world is our faith. Who indeed is the victor over the world, but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the one who came through the water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by water alone, but by water and blood. The Spirit is the one that testifies that the Spirit is truth. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, and whose sins you retain are retained." Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger into the nail marks, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now a week later, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and bring your hand and put it into my side, and do not be unbelieving, but believe." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you come to believe because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed." Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through this belief you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Every year, I come to this day, the second Sunday of Easter, and I wonder what difference last Sunday, Easter Sunday, has made. Are our lives, is our world different because of Easter? And if so, how, in what ways are we different? If you look around, what do you see? Has your life changed? Are you living differently today than you did before Easter? When I look at my life today, it looks a whole lot like it did last Sunday and the week before, and for that matter, weeks before that. And when I look at the world looks pretty much the same. Before Easter, there was a pandemic. After Easter, the pandemic is still here. Before Easter, there was illness and death. After Easter, there is still illness and death. There was pain and brokenness before Easter, and it's still here today. That list of before and after comparisons, it could go on and on. Things look the same. So what do we do with that? I know the usual answers. Jesus has overcome death. Sins are forgiven. Love prevails. All things are made new. Alleluia. Christ is risen. I get all of that. I'm just not sure what it all means or looks like on a day-by-day basis. And I think we all struggle with that. And I think that is why every year on the second Sunday of Easter, we hear the same exact gospel. Every year, we hear the story of the disciples' uncertainty, their fear, their struggle. What are they to do with Jesus' resurrection? And we have the same concern as those first disciples. Now, here's why I say that. The gospel on Easter Sunday morning went like this. While it was still dark, Mary Magdalene discovered the empty tomb. She saw and spoke with Jesus, and he called her by name. She left the garden and went to the disciples and told them, "I've seen the Lord." And what did the disciples say and do? Do you remember? Nothing. They did not do a thing when they heard this message. They didn't jump up and down and shout for joy. They didn't say, "Alleluia, Christ is risen." They were not filled with courage or hope. They didn't make any radical changes in the way that they lived. Instead, they locked the doors. The next thing we hear after Mary's good news is that it was evening, the evening of Easter. The disciples were afraid, and they locked the doors of their house. Jesus steps into the midst of their fear. Locked doors cannot keep Jesus out. They only serve to keep the disciples in. Peace
be with you. And he breathes on them. He gives them the Holy Spirit and sends them even as the Father has sent him. And a week later, what do the Gospels say? Nothing has changed. The disciples are still in the same house behind the same locked doors. And it's hard to see what difference Jesus' resurrection has made for any of them. Jesus is free, but the disciples have imprisoned themselves. The tomb is empty, but the house is full. The stone has been rolled back from Jesus' tomb, but the doors of the disciples' lives are closed and locked. And they are afraid of what's on the other side of those doors. In many ways, that sounds like life today. What doors of your house have you closed? And I'm not talking about social distancing or quarantining. I am asking about the house of your heart, the house of your imagination, the house of love, your house of compassion and hope and courage. Tell me about the house of your marriage. Tell me about the house of your parenting, the house of your forgiving. In what ways have you allowed guilt, regret, anger, disappointment, sorrows, hurts to lock the doors of your life? What doors need to be unlocked and opened for you to live life more wholeheartedly? As long as we live behind the locked doors of our houses, nothing will change. The world today will look the very same as it was before Easter. Our lives will look the same. If today our lives and our world look the same as they did before Easter, then you and I need to start looking for and unlocking some doors. Every time we unlock and open a door in our house, we step into our own resurrection. Easter does make a difference, and the Lord is indeed risen. Easter is Jesus inviting, asking, calling, insisting, and wooing us into life and more life. Easter is Jesus' promise that there is a future on the other side of our locked doors. But it is up to you and to me to unlock and open those doors. Amen. It is through the waters of baptism that we begin to unlock our hearts. So Malcolm and Brittany, I invite you to bring your daughter Emery and your entire family as we gather around the baptismal font. Please stand.
Thank you.
welcome Brittany and all who have gathered here this day. You have come to present your child for baptism by water and the Holy Spirit. She is to receive the gift of new life from God, who is love. On your part, you must make it your constant care to bring her up in the practice of the faith. See that the divine life which God gives her is kept safe from the poison of sin. May that faith life always grow stronger in her heart. If your faith makes you ready to accept this responsibility, I'd invite you to renew your own vows of baptism by rejecting sin and professing your faith in Jesus Christ. This is the faith of the church. This is the faith in which Emery is about to be baptized. And so I invite you to respond, "I do," to the baptismal vows. Do you reject Satan and all of his works and all of his empty promises? "I do." Do you believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? "I do." Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, was crucified, died, and was buried, rose from the dead, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father? "I do." Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? "I do." This is our faith. This is the faith of the Church. We are all proud to profess it in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Brittany and Malcolm, is it your will that your daughter should be baptized in the faith we've all professed with you? And let's see. I'll give you this towel to dry your head. You can put your hand on the shoulders. Can you see well? We can't live without water, can we? We drink water, we play in water, we wash in water. And so this holy water is really a sign of God's love and life flowing over the top of us. And so Brittany, just, there we go. Emery, Jane, Phi, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Dry your head. No. Emery Jane, God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ has freed you from sin and given you new birth by water and the Holy Spirit. He now anoints you with the chrism of salvation. As Christ was anointed priest, prophet, and king, so may you share as a member of his body in the everlasting life of heaven. And I'd ask the four of you to take a hold of her baptismal robe. Emery Jane, you have become a new creation and have clothed yourself in Christ. See in this white garment an outward sign of your Christian dignity, that you may bring unstained into the everlasting life of heaven. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. We're now going to profess forward to the Paschal candle. Malcolm and Britton.
This child of yours has been enlightened by Christ. She swore always to trust God. And she can claim faith alive in her heart when the Lord comes. And she loves me and all the saints in heaven. I could be able to say Agnes. Let us welcome the newest member of our faith community, Emery.
Hallelujah.
us now offer all of our prayers with confidence in the risen Lord, who finds us wherever we are.
Our response will be, "Risen Lord, hear us." That the church may be a confident voice proclaiming that the world is not conquered through violence, hatred, or war, but that true victory comes through faith in Jesus, the Son of God, we pray.
Risen Lord, hear us.
That on this Divine Mercy Sunday, we may avail ourselves of the Lord's forgiveness, confident that his mercy endures forever and extends that forgiveness to those who have harmed us, we pray.
Risen Lord, hear us.
For the recent baptized, especially Emery Jane Fye, that they may grow strong in faith, hope, and love in the body of Christ, we pray.
Risen Lord, hear us.
That at times when our faith is weak, we may have friends, as did Thomas, who do not reject us, but who enable us to experience the Lord in our community, we pray.
Risen Lord, hear us.
That we may see and recognize the many signs of the presence of the Lord in our lives, and through them come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, Son of God, we pray.
Risen Lord, hear us.
That we may know the solidarity between those who have passed to new life and us who are pilgrims as we pray for our beloved deceased. And at this Mass, we especially remember Dorothy Modleski.
Risen Lord,
we pray.
Hear us. Father, we offer these prayers with hearts full of joy at the resurrection of your Son, with gratitude for your unwavering love and care for us, despite our lapses in faith. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. During this pandemic, the collection basket is not passed, but there are baskets at the church doors for your offering. Thank you for your support. Stand and pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be found pleasing and acceptable to our Heavenly Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Accept, O Lord, the offerings of your people, that renewed by confessing the confession of your name and by baptism, they may attain unending happiness. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to acclaim you, O Lord. But in this time, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, a universe cast down is renewed, and integrity of life is restored to us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with Easter joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant that will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of love, together with Francis, the Bishop of Rome, and Terry, our bishop, and all who faithfully serve you. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Joseph, her husband, with the blessed apostles and martyrs, St. Agnes, St. Brendan, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, forever and ever. In the waters of baptism, we become children of a most loving God and are privileged to pray as Jesus, our brother, has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but rather on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your word, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the risen Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let us turn and with words offer a greeting of peace to one another. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ keep us safe for eternal life. For the distribution of Holy Communion, I will put on my mask, sanitize my hands, share the Eucharist with those in the sanctuary, and then Nancy and I will be in the center aisle. You're invited to cross through the pews, coming forward with 6 feet of social distancing. Most people find it convenient to lower your mask just before you receive the Eucharist, and then we very prayerfully return to our pews by the side aisle. Thank you. Let us conclude our prayer. Grant, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal Sacrament may have a continuing effect in our minds and in our hearts. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Just two announcements on this Sunday, Divine Mercy Sunday, at 2:30 at St. Bernard's in Saranac Lake, there will be a celebration of Divine Mercy. The details are in the bulletin. And on behalf of all here in the parish, we congratulate Malcolm and Brittany and their newly baptized daughter, Emery, and their entire family. Congratulations to you. The protocols for leaving the church are important to follow. We begin at the last pew, the one closest to the door, and work our way slowly forward. So thank you for that. And the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God continue to be with us and to bless us always, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our celebration here is ended. Let us go in peace. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.
Please join in singing our closing hymn, At the Lamb's High Feast.